Well, this is mine, but it's here. Okay. So I can start. Yes? Let's wait 1 minute more. Good afternoon to everybody. I will present you today three lectures on scenario analysis and decision support for development of nuclear energy system with enhanced sustainability. And these three lectures include two lectures on the modeling of nuclear energy systems and one lecture on comparison. This activity is performed under the IA International Project on Innovative Nuclear Reactors and Fuel Cycles, shortly INPRA. The content will include the short introduction in INPRA, in International Project of Innovative Reactors and Fuel Cycle. And then I will provide you the main part of the presentation, that is the scenario analysis and decision support tool for enhancing nuclear energy sustainability. And for each part, for NES modeling and for NES comparison, I will give you the exercises on the, including some kind of the very simple calculation for all of those parts. So let's get started with the introduction to INPRA. INPRA was established 18 years ago in 2000 with an overall general objective to help ensure that nuclear energy is available to contribute to meeting global needs by the end of this century and beyond. And this activity of INPRA supports by our INPRA member states. And now it accounts about 42 member countries and international organizations. INPRA activities is one of the IAEA elaborated programs implemented for supporting member states for conducting and nuclear energy studies and to identify role of the nuclear energy in the total national mix. Identify role means that to identify share of the nuclear in the total energy mix, including other non-nuclear sources. The main activities focus on four directions. The first one is the global scenarios. The second, innovation. Then sustainability assessment and strategies. And the last one, dialogue, forum, and outreach. These activities are performed through the so-called collaborative project initiated by the response and by the interest of our member states. And this collaborative project directed to these four directions. For example, collaborative projects on the global scenarios and innovations. The project on, for example, back end of the fuel cycle, on the identification of the role of the collaboration in achieving more sustainable nuclear energy systems, and so on. In my presentation, I will touch only the one direction, global scenarios, not touch other, because of lack of time. So the area or the direction of global scenarios, INPRA has conducted the modeling of the evolution of the nuclear energy system from here to there, from existing nuclear energy system based mostly on the light water reactors and once through fuel cycle, to the targeted, maybe innovative nuclear energy system, which may include, for example, more innovative or advanced technology and closed fuel cycle, with some targeted in the improvement of the performance of the nuclear energy system, enhancing on the resource utilization, in the economics, in backend, and so on. As I said, these activities are performed under the collaborative project. And I will present you here three collaborative projects. One already performed, already finished. This is the GAINS collaborative project, or the global architecture of innovative nuclear energy system, including thermal and fast reactor and closed fuel cycle. This collaborative project and its participants have developed a framework to model nuclear energy system, including a trade relationship, and applied it to a global level. After this framework was developed and it was applied at the global consideration, the participants expressed their interest in application of this framework to the national, on national level for their own country. And so the follow-up project, Synergistic Nuclear Energy Regional Group Interaction, evaluated for sustainability, amended and applied this framework as a national case study with some degree of the cooperation and innovations. Other is collaborative projects, KIND indicator for innovative nuclear energy system development. This collaborative project developed an approach for comparative evaluation of nuclear energy system option based on the set of the selected key indicators and the application of multi-criteria decision analysis. It is an ongoing project, but completed. But we have no, we have publication on GAINS project. Practically, we have now the final state of publication for Synergies. The KIND project is under reviewing, but I think next year we will issue, have the publication. Roadmaps project. This project integrated the outputs of the gains in discount and some other project performed in agency and in other studies. And it has developed a structured approach for mapping the goals toward global sustainable nuclear energy system to be achieved through the two things, through the technology innovation and international cooperation. And I will all this activity accumulated a valuable experience and as the INPRA planning to share this experience with the INPRA member states and not only with member states but for all interested member states by providing them the training on application of relevant software tools. And it will be organized as a new INPRA services to member states. What would I would like to note here that this all project produced not only paper, not only document of publication, but it they produced also tools. I mean the software tools. This is not very complex tools, but they support the case study that member state may would like to perform them. And maybe I will mention somehow this tool here. I often use the term sustainability here. And maybe I would like to provide you some clarification what I mean when I say sustainability or, for example, enhanced sustainability. INPRA has developed the so-called INPRA methodology for NES sustainability assessment. And INPRA methodology defines the basic concept of nuclear energy sustainability. This concept consistent with UN United Nations concept of sustainable development. According to the definition of the Brundtland Report, Our Common Future, sustainable development is the capacity to meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their own needs. And the sustainability of NES within INPRA is understood as a capability of the system to comply with requirements developed within the INPRA methodology. This includes 7 basic principles, 30 user requirements, and more than 100 criteria in the assessment area, such as economics, safety and infrastructure, environment, proliferation resistance, and waste management. Basic principle, this is the goal for development of a sustainable nuclear energy system in each area. User requirements, this is what should be done by designer, operator, industry, or state to meet the goal defined in the basic principles. And criteria. Criteria is assessor tool to check whether a user requirement is being met by a considered NES. NES nuclear energy system that meets all the criteria is deemed to be sustainable. And INPRA is a tool also to identify gaps in sustainability of particular NES, and it also includes the provision for further sustainable enhancement. Some comments of development scenarios. Development scenarios is very useful, is very valuable for the scenario analysis as it can provide a systematic framework for combining a lot of factors and a large number of factors that may drive future development. As other system, the nuclear energy system, interacts with its surrounding. And nuclear energy is a part of the overall energy system. And nuclear energy strategy also is a part of the overall energy strategy. So the potential role of nuclear energy has been evaluated by consideration the all possible supply options, including not nuclear option as well, and taking into consideration such factors as energy resources, energy demand, demographics, macroeconomics, some external environmental factors like climate change, geopolitical situation, international trade and finance. So national decisions on nuclear energy should be evaluated in the context of the a bigger picture for development of a country. And as once the nuclear energy is identified it as a desirable options, the expert may be interested in more detailed evaluation, in more detailed analysis of nuclear energy system, and this is the topic of our presentation. So let me go to the scenario analysis for enhancing nuclear energy sustainability, and I will start from the framework for nuclear energy scenario modeling, and this presentation will present you the main results of the GAIN and Synergies project. So, the collaborative project Global Architecture on Innovation Nuclear Energy System, based on thermal and fast reactors, including closed fuel cycle, as I said already, has developed the framework for nuclear energy evaluation scenario regarding the sustainability. And this evaluation is based on a set of the key indicators in some selected areas. For example, in the areas of mass flows, resources, weights, demands for the front-end and back-end fuel cycle, so fuel services, and for end economics. What allows this framework? It allows to consider targeted nuclear energy system options with enhanced sustainability. GAINS not only developed this framework, GAINS also applied this framework for the analysis of the global scenarios and identified several global architectures with enhanced nuclear energy sustainability. And one of the output of this GAINS is also the, that it showed that enhanced sustainability made it difficult to achieve without broad cooperation between technology holders and technology user country in the nuclear fuel cycle backend, as well in front end. And maybe it somehow the added value to the previous presentation where we discussed that innovation is the necessary to achieve more sustainable future. So the cooperation also could amend this the influence of the or impact of the innovation technologies. There are another project, Synergies project, synergistic nuclear energy regional group interaction evaluated for sustainability. Has amended and applied this framework of, at the national level. In addition, the Synergies has developed a concept of options for enhanced nuclear sustainability, and it confirmed that the enhanced sustainability may be achieved through the improvement in technologies as well in cooperation among different countries, among the technology users, technology holders, and maybe newcomer country. How the GAINS project was organized? It was launched in response to a strong interest expressed by several member states in developing and understanding future trends of nuclear energy development at the global level and the potential role of technical innovations and international cooperation for deployment of sustainable nuclear energy system. And this material that I'll present you in this framework is based on the participants' experience in implementing similar studies at their own country, at national levels, or even at regional or global levels. It was developed to investigate some global trends, but in principle, it's quite flexible and can be applied at a national level to identify some issues, some problems, to understand better the pathway for the national level by they are moving from the here, as I said, to the targeted nuclear energy system. Here I would like to present you the main or major elements of the framework, how this framework is understood by the participant, by the developers of this framework. This framework includes the following elements: nuclear demand assessed for global nuclear energy system, homogeneous and heterogeneous world model, architectures of nuclear energy system, fuel cycle schemes, metrics for scenario analysis. Metrics is the output result that should measure the enhanced nuclear sustainability and to calculate, to evaluate this metrics, expert need some inputs. So these inputs, reactor and fuel data were provided by our participants. And this is also the element of the framework. The very important thing, the assumption. They developed some assumptions. Assumptions impact significantly on the result. Depending on the assumption, you will have the even contradictory result. But it is very important to see what will be so-called what-if scenarios. What will be if you have such demand, or low, or high demand? What will be if you consider implementation of the, for example, this innovation at this time framework or later or in some others? Even some technical assumptions regarding, for example, tail assay, regarding, for example, some technical characteristic in proper way, of course. And to perform such kind of the evaluation, expert may need some tools for this modeling. And within the GAINS project, our experts used either their own codes or tools developed in their own country, or the tools offered by the IEA and INPRA. And maybe I will provide you some short information about tool developed within the INPRA for such purposes. And what also important, the GAINS project developed the framework that includes the inputs, initial data, the outputs, the result, the tools to model the scenario, and also it applied this framework to the framework application, to the some case studies, to see how it works and what result can be obtained from this framework. As I said, all materials now are published, and you see here the our publication. You can find it in the INPRA, not INPRA, but IEA website. And to, if you're interested, you can see more or you can read more detail about this project. And now I will provide you one slide for each of this element to show you this in more detail. So here you see the first and second elements. Nuclear demand assessed for global nuclear energy system and homogeneous and heterogeneous world model. This project started in 2008, so this was the basic year for the consideration of the nuclear demand. The participants did not invite something new. They only analyzed what already was in open publication, in agency aggregation, publication of other, of the in research articles, and in all available reliable sources. After analysis of this publication, they provided their expert opinion what we would like to see as a, or investigate as the nuclear demand. They consider, or the project considered, two scenarios, so-called high scenario, with 5 gigawatt per year of electricity by the end of century, and the middle or medium scenario with the demand 2 times less, 2,500 gigawatt year by the end of the century. And why two scenarios? Because the future is unknown. Nobody knows what will be. So to analyze in deep or in more details the enhancement, it needs to consider at least 2 or even 3 scenarios to understand how the demand may impact or can impact on the result, on the decision, on the indicators. The other things, I think very important thing, the homogeneous and heterogeneous world model. Homogeneous world model is often used for such kind of the scenario analysis. It involves cooperation between all different parts of the world and uniform technology implementation. In terms of this project, it's called synergistic world. Often the world is considered as a, is subdivided into groups. For example, geographical group, as was presented by the previous lecturer. But what was the something new, maybe added value to such kind of scenarios, is the development of the heterogeneous world model based not on the geographical division, but on the technological consideration. Ginz would like to consider the how the cooperation between the different kinds of group with different technologies, to consider this cooperation, they, or the project, considered 3 groups, so-called NG1, non-geographical group 1, with general strategy is to recycle used fuel. This is the the another group, NG2, non-geographical group 2, with general strategy is either directly dispose of spent fuel or reprocess this fuel, for example, abroad in the group NG1. And the third group, NG3 group, this is mostly of newcomer group, with the strategy is not to use fresh fuel. This is not to use them, their own facilities and rely on the services from the group 1 or group 2. They would like to send or is supposed to send their spent fuel abroad for recycle or for disposal, or even if backend strategy is undecided, so-called wait and see strategy. How the nuclear demand was subdivided between these groups? Well, because, as I said, it was the only assumption. Assumption was a soul. At the beginning, or at the base year, the Engie group three is has nothing. And the total demand in this year is subdivided by 50% to the goes to the group one and 50% to group two. By the end of the century, the suppose was as follows: 40% in group one, 30% in group two, and 20% is in group three. And only to understand, this is only assumption, as I said. We don't know really what will be, but what can be done, we can to provide, and this provide, we can provide, and this was done, the sensitivity analysis when the percentage will change between this group and to see how the change of this percent will impact on the result. Let's go further to the next. Nuclear energy system architectures. Gans consider now in principle different kind of architectures, and one of these architectures is so-called business as usual. I think you already hear about this in previous presentation. This nuclear energy system is based on the PVR and HVR, operated in one through fuel cycle. And with the 94% of the light reactors of light water reactors types and 6% of the heavy water reactor types. And this percent of heavy water reactor is kept by the end of the century. This is a homogeneous business as usual world. The another architecture is based on the also homogeneous world, but with the introduction, implementation of the fast reactors. This is based on fast reactors and thermal reactors and the closed fuel cycle. The heterogeneous system that includes, that comprises the group one, group two, and group three is considered as follows. Group one, NG1, has the thermal and fast reactors operated in closed fuel cycle. Group two, thermal reactor in on through fuel cycle. And group three also thermal reactors, but with minimal infrastructure. Other architectures were also evaluated and analyzed, like, for example, a nuclear energy system, including the components of the such system as accelerated driving systems, ADS, or multi-solid reactors, to consider the utilization of minor actinides in the system, and the thorium-based reactors and the related fuel cycle were also considered. Here you see the full list of the reactors and architectures. Associated nuclear fuel cycle schemes. Here I would like to present you the only two schemes. Schemes for ONS through fuel cycle, for business as usual scenario, and for the combined ONS through fuel cycle with fast reactors and closed fuel cycle, in order you to understand clearly when I will provide you the, for example, some initial data or results. The ONS through fuel cycle includes the two types of reactors, light water reactors and heavy water reactors, and the front-end steps and back-end steps. Front-end steps include the uranium mining, conversion, enrichment for light water reactors, the depleted storage, the fabrication of the corresponding fuels for heavy water reactors and light water reactors, the NPP storage, schooling storage, and so-called long-term storage for storing the discharged fuel. And the combined on-through and fast reactors, nuclear fuel science schemes, include additional, here you see additional advanced light water reactors, but it's not obviously, but what important, it is includes the fast reactors. And you see here the new steps, the steps of reprocessing of the spent fuel from light water reactor and from fast reactor, and recycling the separated plutonium and maybe uranium in the fast reactors. And you see here the long storage for the, for example, heavy water reactors, because the heavy water reactors is not involved in the closed fuel cycle. And if necessary, for the other types of reactors and storage for the radioactive waste after reprocessing. Here you see the matrix. Matrix, this is the key indicator, and sometimes it includes supplemented funds for the, by the evaluation parameter for scenario analysis. Initially, in-prem methodology included four indicators. But for evaluation and comparison of the system regarding the future possible enhanced sustainability, it was decided to have a lower number of key indicators. So-called, it was developed as a concept, the idea of key indicators. And the idea is that these key indicators would have a distinctive capability for capturing the essence of a given area. That, and that they would provide, these key indicators would provide a mean to establish targets in the specific area to be reached via improving technical or infrastructural characteristics. So we need to clearly understand what does mean if this indicator less or more, is it better or not? This is for, we need to define the target for these indicators. And you see here the table of the indicators. The table includes, you see the power production, nuclear material resources area, discharge fuel, radioactive waste in minor actinides, fuel cycle services in front end and back end, and economics and safety. In order to somehow evaluate, to calculate metrics, experts need the input data. And input data sometimes is a big issue to collect this data to calculate this metrics. It's very, not very easy task. We need the data on reactors and fuel cycle. And those data were provided by our participants. Our participants provided to us those reactor types that we are interested in. And they, for example, include the low, medium, and high burn-up light water reactors, heavy water reactors of different types, sodium-cooled fast reactors of different conversion or breeding ratios. They also provided to us some data for some selected ADS and MSR for minor actinide burning, thorium-based reactors fueled by the, or either for the thorium and plutonium fuel, oxide fuel, or the thorium or uranium-33 and plutonium fuel. This is the, was the kind of type of reactors. And here you see the major specification of the reactors. It's the same for the all types of reactors. And here you see the major specification of one of the fast reactors. And you see that it includes the what type of data we need to provide our analysis. It includes the reactor net electric capacity, thermal output, thermal efficiency. This is only dividing second by first. Average load factors. Among important fuel residence time, specific power density, average discharge build-up. And here you see also the average characteristics, because the main idea was to provide the scenario in enough simple way, so not to consider the separate mass flow from the core and from the Blanken, so they were mixed and considered as one whole. But it's not necessary. It was done in Gaines, but not necessary done for national study. In addition to this, the fuel cycle data was provided. And fuel cycle data is more difficult even than to have this data, to find this data is more difficult than to find this specification. Maybe they are simple, but if you would like to find them, you may face with some problem. But if you go to our publication, you will find all this data printed there. But what else? The content of fresh fuel and content of the discharge fuel. This is very important for analysis of the closed fuel cycle when you need to know the share, the content of plutonium or minor actinide in spent fuel for their further recycling. And as I said, a lot of the scenario were performed, but I would like you to present results for some selected scenario only to demonstrate, to illustrate the possible key the possible result, the possible metrics that I already show you. Here you see the light water and fast reactor production comparison in two scenarios. In business as usual scenarios plus means that the scenarios is supposed to have not only light water reactors and heavy water reactors, but as well advanced light water reactors of some more or less advanced characteristic in comparison with light water reactor. And the second scenario is the scenario of business as usual plus FR with the introduction of fast reactors. Here I would like to say that the scenario is a high scenario. And the result for the medium scenario is something another. But maybe it is interesting to consider the different kind of scenarios to understand the issue more clearly. Here I will provide you, I will illustrate you only this high scenario. And what we see? We see that according to the assumption, advanced light water reactors in business as usual scenario are introduced in 2015 and gradually replaced all light water reactors. Heavy water reactor is kept as 6% during all time frame. The second scenario, as I said, includes the fast reactor. It started from the 2030, and achieves about 400 gigawatt per year by the middle of the century. After the century, this is also the break-even reactor with bridging ratio on. After in the second part of the century, from the 2050 by the end, the assumption was that the fast reactor will be introduced as much as possible according to availability of plutonium. FR reactor's introduction is restrained by the zero breeding of the performance, and so we have some maximum share by the end of the century, and this share was about half, about 44% by the end of the century. And you see here the result. Here I would like to present the cumulative natural uranium requirements for this high scenario. And according to the calculation, to the matrix, by the end of the century, the total mass of consumed natural uranium would reach practically 37.8 million tons for business as usual case. But in a scenario of fast reactor introduction, uranium consumption is by 12 million tons lower than for the business as usual. So you see the, how the implementation of the, or introduction of the innovation, such as flat reactors, impact on the uranium consumption. And this is in accordance with the previous presentation, but the number a little bit different because of there is, this is the high scenario, and the previous consideration provided you the, well, in our terms, medium scenarios. So this is a little bit, the trends is similar, but the number is another. For example, the conventional natural uranium resources, that is about 16 million tons, will be exhausted by 2070 for the business as usual scenario plus, and 15 years later for 2085 in business as usual FR scenario. So I would like to present you the another important thing, the cumulative amount unspent fuel for both scenarios. As you can see, the total amount of spent fuel discharged from the reactors for the business as usual plus scenario reaches 5.5 million tons by the end of the century. But the amount of the spent fuel from light water reactors can be significantly reduced. You see, the significantly means this is like red, practically reduced by zero due to the introduction, due to the implementation of fast reactors. The yellow part belongs to the heavy water reactors. There is no any reduction of this part because according to the assumption, heavy water reactor reactors operate in once per fuel cycle, so there is no any difference between this spent fuel accumulated in both reactor types. In both scenarios, excuse me, please. Here I would like to see, to show you the, I have shown you the heterogeneous global world and the results for the global world. Now I would like to present you some outputs for the synergistic and non-synergistic heterogeneous world. And this figure shows the potential of fast reactor implementation or deployment. Then blue line shows the non-synergistic world, and the red line shows the synergistic worlds. And you see that the global fleet of fast reactors could be doubled in the synergistic case comparison to the non-synergistic case. And this would lead to in reduction, accumulation of discharge fuel, as you see, and the saving of uranium resources. And here I would like to present you also the results from the consideration of the synergistic and non-synergistic world. Two curves here. This curve shows the plutonium accumulation in three cases. The first one, this is the blue, dark blue case. This is the homogeneous world based on the business as usual scenario. And you see that in this case, the progressive increase in plutonium in spent fuel will be progressively increased. The second curve, the Rose curve, shows the heterogeneous world model, but non-synergistic, without any interaction between groups, and but with introduction of fast reactors in group one. And in this case, we see there's some reduction in accumulation rate, but in this case, there is no the fully solve of this issue of problem. It's solved somehow, but not fully. Even if fast reactors innovation will be deployed in group country who would like to implement this new innovation. And the last one is the curve, green curve. This is the curve for the synergistic global world. And synergistic globalness give an opportunity to reduce plutonium accumulation to a minimum stock, as you see. This is also interested, maybe this is the result. So I would like to maybe repeat, but it's important, some the output of the GAINS project. First, it provides the framework for analysis of the global architectures, and these architectures can be applied, and this framework can be applied at global and regional level. But it also allows to do something new, to develop national nuclear strategies, explore cooperation or partnership with other countries in nuclear fuel cycle, explore regional options or solutions for nuclear fuel cycle, and highlight global trends and how they may affect on national developments. Now I will go to the collaborative project synergies. As I said, this is a follow-up project. After developing the framework and applying it at a global level, the country would like to apply them at national level. And you see here the list of countries, more than 20 countries were involved in this project and expressed to perform and to apply this framework to the national study and to explore the similar issue regarding the national nuclear energy system. As project calls synergies, I would like maybe to clarify the term synergies with the context of the project or in the context of the nuclear energy. This is synergies are those actions that country or group of country may undertake to facilitate, that means enable, accelerate, optimize the deployment of nuclear energy system with enhanced sustainability. And all synergies were systemized in two groups. First one includes synergies which are essentially technical nature and can be considered within one country. The second one comprises the cases where the combination of nuclear energy system across country may bring benefits for each country, even if one of these countries wouldn't be able to achieve. So this is the cooperation. So we have the two mechanisms for enhanced sustainability via technological innovation and via the cooperation enhancement. As I said, the Synergies project has developed the technological option for net sustainability. And this includes six options. First one, one through nuclear fuel cycle. This is practically business as usual, our scenario based on the thermal reactors and one through fuel cycle. Recycle of spent nuclear fuel with only physical processing. This means that at least should be two types of reactors, and spent fuel from one reactor goes without chemical, but only with physical processing to another reactor type. Limited recycling of spent nuclear fuel. This mainly involved the thermal reactor-based fuel cycle, with, for example, single recycle of the plutonium in thermal reactor. Complete recycle of spent nuclear fuel. This is maybe based on the MOX fuel involving plutonium. It may be the thorium-based reactors. And it includes the closed fuel cycle of the recycling of the recycled product. The minor actinides or minor actinides and fissile product transmutation. And final geological disposal of all waste. The final geological disposal of waste should be the part of the final state of the previous options. For example, it may be a final geological disposal of spent nuclear fuel for once fuel cycle or other high-level waste, including minor actinides or and fusion products or even only fission products for the closed fuel cycle. Regarding collaborative enhancement, the benefits of innovation in technology could be amplified through the collaboration among countries, including holders, technology user countries. But nuclear trade is more complex compared to the trade involving conventional goods. Before any contract in nuclear trade is put in place, agreement between countries need to be conducted. And this may be the bilateral agreement, multiple bilateral agreements, or multilateral agreements. A bilateral agreement is an umbrella trade and cooperation agreement signed as a treaty between two trading partners, and it should describe the legal structure and obligation of the two parties. Multiple bilateral agreements are several bilateral agreements. A multilateral agreement is a moire agreement for cooperation. That is an umbrella trade and cooperation agreement signed as a treaty between a larger set of trading partners. So it could be regional, for example, Euratom. What is important is that the preparing and signing the agreements of nuclear trade may require changing national laws and carry out lengthy negotiation with targeted partners. And it may take a long time. Let me see. Half an hour, yes, I have. I try to control the time as well. So the participants of the collaborative project Synergies discussed as well so how a solid basic for cooperation could be established. And it could be established through the bringing together decision makers and decision senior technical experts from member state institution, non-government organization, nuclear industry, utilities, and so on. The second thing is the understanding of the nuclear technology developers countries and user countries standpoints regarding the driving forces and impediments for such cooperation. And finally, identifying viable cooperation option based on win-win approach to reach the national net sustainability in regional and global context. What motivation or factors or drivers should be taken into account in this consideration. Here I will show you only some of them, not all. For example, energy policy consideration. National policies should consider the potential to become a regional provider of energy once the national needs are fulfilled. Benefits related to cost and application of nuclear technology have to be taken into account. And the development of a large market would lead to increase the potential of country for benefits and reduction of financial burdens due to the collaborative and sharing efforts. The sharing of the other things, sharing of facilities and resources, is so very important, and the following should be considered: R&D collaboration, sharing experience on licensing, regulation, environmental assessment, extent of specialized human resources, infrastructure sharing, training, etc. Security supply and advanced management in the zone should be taken into account. The supply of security is in direct connection to ensure NPP cooperation. The management consideration includes the long-term interim spent fuel storage, and also the reprocessing and recycling of spent nuclear fuel. What interesting, the questionnaire showed that in average, technology user country, technology countries, user country and newcomer country identify the number of free supplier as a guarantee for the security of supply. You have some choice. What impediments to collaboration should be taken into account? First, the national regulation. National regulation still have essentially a national focus on sometimes, and sometimes prohibit synergistic collaboration with other country. National law often prohibit accepting third parties' ultimate weights for storage and final disposal. In this regard, it was interesting, the one discussion, spent fuel, is it a waste or is it resource? The answer is very interesting. The next, the long-term nature of nuclear energy project and high capital investment is, of course, impediments, as it requires a long-term commitment in changing social, political, and economic environment. Political environment. Nuclear technology can be considered as a competitive advantage in a region and could impede establishing a cooperation in a country, mainly because of the tendency to dominate a region as a provider of the energy. And at the same time, the unavailability of similar technology can impede cooperation in a country, as it requires the costly infrastructure and public concern for sure. Radiation is a common factor for concern associated with nuclear energy. And decreasing of public acceptance of nuclear energy development, especially after Fukushima accident, could take into account as an impediment in cooperation among country. The public concern are transported in the level of public acceptance and often influenced on the willingness of government towards nuclear energy development. So the public concern diminishing will consequently lead to positive reactions and better public acceptance for nuclear energy. As I said, more than 20 countries performed their case study within the synergies project. And among these 28 case studies, 21 explicitly addressed synergies in technology, 20 addressed synergistic collaboration in nuclear fuel cycle with a link to synergies in technology, And we'll touch upon the cooperative solution on regional or global level. For the future nuclear system to be globally sustainable, a combination of the various synergistic collaborative solutions may be needed, depending on the pace of the nuclear capacity growth. Maybe I will very shortly go through some example, some like case study, not go in deep, but on list and provide some maybe very short description. Two studies addressed the issue related to the sustainability enhancement of several regional cooperation. And these two studies include the first European Union 27 scenarios with the extended use of regional fuel cycle center, consisting of Lach, Yuk, and Melox facilities, and demonstrated proven options for the synergistic collaboration between nine European Union countries. This approach includes the light water reactors and the commercial reprocessing and using of MOX fuel supply for a single recycle in light water reactors. And this study presents main drivers, some of the such as preservation of the natural resources, not much, but nevertheless, reduction minimization of the generated waste, and some economical data. Other study includes the study performed jointly by Armenia, Belarus, Russian Federation, and Ukraine. You see here how it was organized. This study represents the user country, newcomer country, and holder country, and to show how they can interact for the win-win cooperation. French case study. The objective of French study on radioactive waste transmutation option was to obtain an assessment on industrial perspective on partitioning and transmutation of long-lived radioactive elements. And this study showed that only the transmutation of all minor octani enables stabilization on the inventory all the time. I don't go in deep, I only list them. China and Japan case study. This two case study considered the introduction of fast reactors, but in a completely different scenarios. And they show the positive effect of this introduction. In the first case, when China considered the intensive growth of their demand, and Japan, in this scenario at least, considered the reduction of the role of nuclear energy, of nuclear energy within the scenario. But both scenarios identified the positive impact of innovation in these different scenarios. Then case studies from Argentina, Indonesia, Romania, and Ukraine addressed a model of nuclear power development and deployment in which the domestic nuclear R&D programs is combined with participation in international R&D programs. This study showed something similar and something different. For example, Argentina showed that they would like to develop capabilities as a nuclear technology country. The plans are to become a supplier of a small reactors of Argentina design. This is the study from Armenia. This study considered the nuclear energy system with minimum infrastructure, with the providing of services in front-end and back-end outside. And they consider the expediency of introduction of small reactors into the national NES. So, Gaines and Sigrid's project have found that potential benefits for cooperation among countries will minimize infrastructure effort for individual countries. suggest a solution for spent nuclear fuel utilization and disposal, enable optimal use of available resources, minimize cost owing to the economy of scale and other factors. However, such a collaborative effort would be possible only when assuring that related driving forces overcome the impediments. And some conclusion. Synergies of a widely used light water reactors with the reactors of other type, for example, sodium fast reactors, ADS, or MSR, can provide essential improvement of sustainability indicators in the area of radioactive waste management, rational use of fissile materials, and proliferation resistance. However, harmonization with some other indicators of the system, and first of all with economics, is required. The collaborative synergies in the form of the bilateral or multiple bilateral win-win cooperation would help spreading the benefits of innovative technologies developed in technology countries to all countries in the world. So even countries who have no innovation can benefit from this innovation through the cooperation. This is a simple thing. And some technical, economic, and political impediments in realization of potential of synergistic approaches were identified. Better understanding of the impediments and finding the pathway to overcome them is critically important to define them and implement joint actions to enhance availability and sustainability of global nuclear energy system. And this is practically end of my presentation, practical part. Now I would like you to present some exercises, but before to present them, I would like to show you this document issued by INPRA titled User Guide for Modeling Nuclear Energy System with Message. This document includes the detailed description of the tool developed within INPRA project for modeling of nuclear energy system. And here you can find how the message, this is a specific program supported by AA, can be used to model the nuclear energy system at each level. But for our exercises, we don't need this tool. I would like to present you or to give you the exercise. But for 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock is the finish of my presentation. Yes, not? After exercises, because exercises is somehow connected. Maybe it's to finish everything. 5 minutes. I will try to have the 10 minutes for this exercise. I have presented you some key indicators that shows the some enhancement in the, for example, resources, in spent fuel management, and so on. And I have shown you the input data. And to have this result, we need to prepare to use some tools and to prepare to understand how it can be modeled. And I would like you now to explain how it can be done. What is the starting point to do some model? First of all, you need to start from the fuel cycle scheme for your system. For example, very simple system with only light water reactor. And to understand the fuel cycle services, the requirements for the conversion, for the resources, for the storage, and so on, you need to calculate the mass flow first. And here you see the calculation of mass flow, this data. If you find this data somewhere, or somebody will provide you this, if you have this, it's okay. But often you have no this, and you need to calculate. Here you see the input data taken from our product. This is the left table. This is the data, unit, and the symbol. And here you see the indicators that we use to analyze our nuclear energy system. You see here the name, unit, equation, how to calculate according to the symbol, and the result. And here the sum for separate working units, some maybe qualification. So you can calculate, and in this case you have this table. Based on this table, you can do very simple analysis. But if you have this scheme for each reactor types, and you have the capacity of these reactor types, you can calculate more complex picture with the necessary result. Here I would like only to show you some specific to the nuclear fuel. All data are provided in kiloton or ton or kilogram heavy metal. Heavy metal, this is, includes only uranium, americium, uranium, minor actinides, maybe thorium. It excluded all constructive materials or some other isotope like oxygen, for example. This is only a short term. And the first question, the first example, to do the same for the advanced light water reactor, to calculate all mass flow and to see, do you have better or worse or maybe the same? For this, you have this table with input data. You have the table with the necessary output in formulas. And you need only to calculate and maybe to compare and to analyze the light water reactors and advanced, with some advanced characteristics. And the another is the same for the fast reactors. Here's the scheme. And you need to calculate all these questions. For this, I give to you this table with some spent fuel content, because now you have closed fuel cycle. And the table with equation, you can analyze, find, or discuss them. This equation is in something different from the first one because the input data is slightly different. Okay. And this is all for this first time of exercises. You need to calculate the mass flow to provide, not mass flow analysis, but mass flow calculation of some extent of analysis for advanced light water reactors and for the fast reactors. And I gave you some example for the light water reactor. This is all for this presentation, for this part. And the second, after coffee break, will be the approach for comparative evaluation of nuclear energy system. I have even more than 5 minutes. Maybe I will slightly quickly. But that's everything what I would like to present you on the first part, modeling of nuclear energy system.